In this video, we're going to discuss the three lines of defense and look into more detail into those first two lines. Our immune system has a very important job, and that is protecting us from foreign cells. Now, while our body is made out of trillions of cells, there are just as many non-human cells around. Now, some of those non-human cells are harmless. In fact, some are even beneficial. However, some of those microorganisms are pathogens. Pathogens are microorganisms that cause disease, and it's these organisms that our immune system is designed to protect us from. Now, whether we're talking about pathogens or our own human cells or even symbiotic or beneficial bacteria, all cells have surface signature molecules. Foreign cells will have different signature molecules than self cells. And the name for these signature molecules are antigens. So we'll talk about how these signature molecules are used in our immune system and the different lines of defense that our immune system has. But again, ideally, our internal defenses will attack foreign cells and pathogenic cells, but not self cells. So looking at the three lines of defense that our immune system has, the first line of defense are the external barriers. Now, this line of defense includes physical and chemical barriers, and it is nonspecific, meaning that the response isn't going to be any different depending on what signature molecules a cell has, and it's just a general defense. Now, our other two lines of defenses are internal defenses, with our innate immunity being our second line of defense, and our adaptive immunity being our third line of defense. Now, the innate immune system is also nonspecific, and we'll see that it has both cellular and chemical components. It's only our third line of defense, our final line of defense, the adaptive immune system, that actually is specific and will produce different responses depending on which signature molecules it sees on the invading cells. So let's look at these lines of defense in a bit more detail, starting with that first line of defense. The human body's first line of defense is a set of external barriers and chemical agents, and the job of these barriers are to prevent foreign invaders from getting inside. There are several physical barriers, including an outer layer of intact skin, hair within our nostrils, mucous membranes which line the respiratory system and the orifices of our body, and also cilia. Here we actually see an electron micrograph of the cells that are lining our trachea, or the main windpipe leading towards our lungs. Now, you may remember in a previous video we talked about the effect of smoking on the respiratory system. It's these cilia that would end up getting singed and becoming non-functional. Now, the orange spongy-looking cells around them, those are the mucous membranes. They secrete the sticky adhesive mucus, hoping to catch pathogens and dust particles and other things, and then the cilia will help sweep those out of the respiratory system. Well, if the cilia are non-functional, then those pathogens are not able to be removed from the body, and so infections and a chronic cough can result. Now, in addition to the physical defenses that we have, the body also employs nonspecific chemical defenses in this first line of defense. This includes our sweat, saliva, and tears, which all contain antimicrobial chemicals. And these chemicals, again, they aren't really specific. They aren't looking at what signature molecules something has. They're just a general barrier or block for microorganisms. There are also glands in the skin, which produce oils and acids. Now, just to be clear, it's not that the surface of our body is sterile. It's not that there are no bacteria living on us. In fact, there are many bacteria on us. But these oils and acids, They prevent these bacteria from colonizing or to make open wounds or sores that could break through these external barriers. Our second line of defense is the innate immune system, when invaders penetrate the body's external barriers. A set of nonspecific internal defenses that depend mostly on white blood cells act as a second line of defense, and this is known as innate immunity. So our innate immune system, this is our second line of defense. It is an immediate response to foreign invaders. It doesn't take a while to build up. In fact, as soon as the body detects that the outer barriers have been breached, the second line of defense is activated. A major part of the component of the second line of defense are a particular category of white blood cells known as macrophages. So these are white blood cells that engulf pathogens by phagocytosis. Now here in this image, the brownish-orangish cell, that is a bacterial cell. But what you may not realize is that all of that gray material around it, that's just a part of a macrophage. This white blood cell had surrounded that bacterial cell using its pseudopods. And in essence, it has performed phagocytosis and endocytosis, bringing material into the cell. This white blood cell is then going to digest and break down this bacterial cell. It might even filter through and see what signature molecules were present, and then display those signature molecules to let the other white blood cells know what happened to have been around, what pathogens may have entered our body. Other nonspecific internal defenses include chemicals. That either attack microbes directly or at least impede their reproduction. So here we see our nonspecific internal defenses. Again, this is our innate immune system. And it is our second line of defense. It is made up of both cellular components, such as the phagocytes, like macrophages and neutrophils, but then also NK cells, which we'll see destroy infected body cells, cells that have a viral infection. There are also nonspecific defensive proteins, like interferons and complement proteins. We'll look at these in the next few slides. Complement proteins are given that name because they complement the action of the leukocytes. These proteins work together with various results, such as poking holes in the membranes of foreign cells, acting as a marker to identify foreign cells, tagging them to be consumed by white blood cells. And they also even attract or recruit neutrophils. Which are another type of phagocytic white blood cell. Conversely, interferon is a communication molecule that is released by cells if they've detected that they've been infected by a virus. Now, it doesn't matter what virus it is, it doesn't matter what signature molecules are on that virus. If a cell knows that it's been infected by a virus, it releases interferon. Now, interferon does a few things. One, it's going to let neighboring healthy cells know that viruses are in the area and that they should start making proteins to defend themselves against viruses. Another thing that interferon does is that it will attract NK cells. So interferon, it's a nonspecific defense against viruses. It is a protein released by virus-infected cells. It stimulates and protects neighboring cells, causing them to produce antiviral proteins. And it also recruits natural killer cells. These white blood cells, once they're activated, they look for for the cells that are releasing interferon, and they actually go to those cells and destroy them. Now, at first you might wonder, why is a cell advertising that it's been infected with viruses if it's just going to be destroyed? And this doesn't really make sense if you look at it just at an individual cellular level. But as a multicellular organism, it's in our best interest for survival if our infected cells identify themselves, and in essence, take one for the team to allow the rest of the body to survive. And that's exactly what these cells that release interferon do. The final aspect of the innate immune system that I'd like to discuss is inflammation. Now, inflammation, like these other immune responses, is going to be triggered regardless of which signature molecules are present on the invading cells. In fact, it really just takes tissue damage to initially release the molecules that will trigger inflammation. Now let's look just a bit at what inflammation is. Inflammation is nonspecific. Immune response to tissue damage. Inflammation will actually be triggered whether pathogens have been introduced or not. If there's tissue damage, the cells release communication molecules which will trigger inflammation. These communication molecules are histamines and prostaglandins. These inflammation molecules will trigger the four symptoms of inflammation. Those four symptoms include redness, which is the result of increased blood flow to the area, swelling, which is the result of increased permeability of the capillaries, heat, which is increased metabolism and phagocytosis in the area. You can almost think of it as a very localized fever. And lastly, pain. Now the pain is there because of pressure or damage to the nerve endings. It also lets us know that something is wrong or that something needs our attention. So these four symptoms are the symptoms of inflammation. Again, this is all part of that second line of defense, the nonspecific innate immune system. Now why is it that tissues perform inflammation? Well, it helps to seal off the damaged area and potentially prevent pathogens that were introduced from spreading. Platelets end up forming a blood clot, which will also help limit pathogen spreading through the area. Macrophages are also recruited and activated during inflammation so that they might be able to take care of these foreign invading cells before a serious infection starts. That takes us to the end of our discussion of these first two lines of defense. In the next video, we'll discuss the third line of defense, the adaptive immune system. See you in the next video.